My lord, on behalf of Guardian Newspapers Limited, I endorse all that my learned friend has said. My clients now appreciate that the allegations made in their article were incorrect, and through me wish to express their sincere apologies to McDonald's for the damage done to the company's reputation.
The publishers of Today newspaper accept that their defamatory allegations against the plaintiff were unfounded, should never have been printed, and consequently they withdraw them.
On behalf of the defendant, I accept everything that my learned friend has said. I would add that Channel 4 welcomes this opportunity to apologise to McDonald's.
We apologise to McDonald's for any embarrassment.
I recognise that the allegations against McDonald's
practices and policies are beyond reproach.
Paid a suitable sum of damages.
No truth in any of these damages.
The above statement is unfair and untrue.
The owners shall not knowingly allow the play to be performed again.
We ask you to accept our apology.
What they've actually done is to hold McDonald accountable to society on behalf of society. And I think they're heroes of our time.
Hold your bag up.
It really began with one person, with Helen, just saying, I can't apologize. Just one person saying, no, I won't bow down.
Well, when I was quite young, there was a boy at the end of our street who used to basically bully everyone around. And everyone used to go crying to their mums and dads, you know. And I think eventually my mum got sort of fed up with it and just said, well, hit him back. So I did. And after that, he didn't hassle me anymore. Well, it's the same with McDonald's, really. You know, if somebody's trying to make you do something that you don't believe in, then you have to stand up to them and say, no, I'm not going to do it. You know, I'm not going to give in to your intimidation and bullying.
When Charlie was two, I split up with his mum. And really, for about the last 4 years, I've been looking after Charlie on my own, which is obviously a job in itself, full-time job, and a big responsibility.
I have responsibility to encourage him to question things, for him to be himself and not just, like, be obsessed with the next Power Rangers toys. He's growing up in a very hostile environment. All the images that are forced on kids from advertising, the media, it's all bombarding him, telling him the way the world should be.
Well, me and Dave have been friends since the 80s. I was working as a gardener and Dave used to be a postman. We share a lot of the same beliefs and we also both feel it's important to stand up for what you believe in.
It's not a personal battle between me and Helen and McDonald's. This is about the public's right to know what the most powerful organisations in the world, which are multinational corporations, are really doing.
7th of January 1988. I've started going regularly to a local campaign group, London Greenpeace, unrelated to well-known Greenpeace. We meet once a week in North London to arrange protests on various social and environmental issues. There had been lots of groups campaigning against McDonald's around the world on specific issues, like, you know, rainforest groups in the States and in Australia. There were trade unionists fighting for better working conditions. There were nutritionists criticising McDonald's for the junk food. There were animal welfareists campaigning about the way that animals were reared and slaughtered. But I think that it was London Greenpeace that really drew all the criticisms together. The What's Wrong with McDonald's leaflets focused on the unhealthy food, the working conditions, animal cruelty, plus the environmental damage and advertising to children.
Do you like
the McDonald's campaign has picked on a company that's so much in the public eye, that seems to symbolise a whole system, a whole way of life. To have a leafleting, an educational campaign against McDonald's, is putting the alternative point of view. But of course, I just had no idea what it would lead to, that later it would just completely take over my life.
8th of February 1990. London Greenpeace meeting tonight. There's been a few new people in recent months who don't seem genuine. Who are they?
Assignment number L11389. As instructed, I left the office at 7 p.m. on the above date and travelled to the office of subject group. Pressing the bell push labelled Greenpeace resulted in the door being opened by a woman of Oriental extraction. I introduced myself with a fictitious name. She did not ask for any other details, and she appeared not to be much interested in my background.
This guy turned up at the meetings who didn't quite seem to sort of, you know, fit in. He didn't really say that much about what his politics were. But at the time, we just sort of thought, well, you know, maybe he's a policeman, but we're not doing anything wrong or illegal or anything, so, well, why worry about it?
I knew that Helen suspected that there were some kind of infiltrators in the group. And I said, don't be stupid, that's just something which, you know, you read about in books.
My role was actually to notice everything that was happening, where it was being held, describe the place that it was being held in, the people who were there, what they were wearing, what their names were, and everything that was said, and in particular, everything that was said in relation to McDonald's.
One of the spies, Alan Clare,
stole letters, broke into the office to take photographs, followed people home.
We were infiltrated for about 18 months by 7 different spies from 2 different agencies. McDonald's hadn't told them about being 2 firms, and so they were spying on each other some of the time.
And at some meetings, there were as many spies as there were campaigners.
I was asked to introduce another person into the group. Her name was Michelle Hooker, and I believe she was an ex-policewoman. I was quite surprised when she came along for the first time because I thought I had to sort of dress down and wear sandals and sort of hippie-type clothes, you know. But she used to drive up in a black BMW. She used to give me a lift in it.
And she got very heavily involved with the group. You know, she organised meetings, she organised pickets.
She even had a 6-month relationship with somebody in the group and stayed with his family over Christmas.
I managed to find in a drawer bank statements for London Greenpeace. They bank with the cooperative bank Islington.
Went account on to the Malton Hops public house. While here, the conversation turned to Dave Morris, and I learned that he lives in Tottenham. He has a son who is called Charlie, and he was born...
One of them wanted to get my address, and he asked someone in the group what my address was because he wanted to send me some baby clothes for my son Charlie. And he actually sent these clothes to me, which Charlie wore.
It wasn't until several years later that we found out the real reason that they wanted our home addresses.
21st of September 1990. 5 of us in the group have received libel writs over the What's Wrong with McDonald's leaflets.
I think it was dark, and there was a guy standing in front of me as I stepped from the van, and he said, Helen. And I didn't say anything because I didn't know who he was. And he just threw this envelope at my feet, and when I picked it up and opened it, it was the writ. In with the writ was a letter saying that there'd be a court case unless we apologised.
After the writs were served, we had 2 hours of free legal aid, which effectively meant being told you've got no chance.
The other 3 people who'd had the writs they felt that, you know, they didn't really have any choice but to sort of apologise because of the odds being stacked against us. But for me, it just sort of really stuck in the throat to apologise to McDonald's. You know, I didn't think that we'd done anything that deserved an apology. I thought it was them that should be apologising to us. Well, not us specifically, but to society for the damage that they do to society and the environment.
Really, when Helen said she was going to go for it, I thought, I'm going to go for it too, because two is better than one.
Even though, you know, we were being told it was, like, a virtually impossible battle, me and Dave decided to carry on and fight it anyway, come what may, really.
The world's largest fast food business, McDonald's, has begun a libel action at the High Court against two environmental campaigners.
Dave Morris and Helen Steel are accused of claiming that McDonald's products caused ill health and destroyed rainforests.
McDonald's argued that we should be denied a jury because a jury would find the issues in the case too complex to deal with.
And we just thought, oh, you know, that'll be thrown out. It's just so ridiculous. You know, we've got to understand it. We're ordinary members of the public, so, you know, why can't a jury understand what's going on? But much to our horror, it wasn't just thrown out. You know, the judge went along with their argument and ruled that we wouldn't have a jury.
And basically that meant we were left presenting the case to a judge on his own, Mr. Justice Bell.
McDonald's hired one of the top libel barristers in the country, Richard Rampton QC. He gets about £2,000 a day. He brought with him a junior barrister, Timothy Atkinson, and also a head solicitor, Patty Brinley Codd, and a whole team of about seven solicitors and clerks working behind the scenes.
And meanwhile, we were defending ourselves.
The fast food company McDonald's has begun a High Court libel action against two environmental campaigners. In court this morning, counsel for McDonald's said the allegations were totally false.
So far as McDonald's are concerned, anybody is free to express his criticism in whatever form he wishes. McDonald's may not like it, but they would never try to prevent it. They cannot and do not object to fair and reasonable and honest criticism of their business or their products.
We just had no idea of the procedure or what we had to say or when we had to say it, you know, who spoke in what order.
We were just treated like, you know, what are these people doing in my courtroom? That's the attitude we got. I mean, the first hearing, we asked the judge to explain the procedures, and he said, if you don't know the procedures, you should be represented. And we said, well, there's no legal aid, what are we meant to do?
We pride ourselves on having a legal system which is the best in the world, and we pride ourselves on the fact that we've all got free speech. But in reality, of course, that simply isn't the situation.
You don't get free lawyers for libel cases, so we had to represent ourselves. But luckily, Keir came along early on and volunteered to help us out with legal advice.
I immediately saw that McDonald's had a very strong legal team and that it was a complicated case raising all sorts of issues. And as soon as I saw the imbalance, I decided that I would do what I could to help them.
The libel laws in England and Wales are notoriously anti-free speech because of the burdens they put on defendants to prove so much of the case. So in this case, David and Helen have to prove the truth of everything that's in the leaflet. McDonald's can sit back and prove nothing. That's a huge and disproportionate burden.
My Lord, the topic is nutrition. The issue, as I pose it, is this. Does the plaintiff's food constitute a significant hazard to human health?
Dr. Arnott, is it not a fact that many responsible international, governmental and academic organisations have said that they consider there's a link between diet and cancer, although the factors are not known precisely? Would that be reasonable?
I think what is true to say is that people have suggested that there may well be a link between diet and various forms of cancer, although one has not been able to show that in scientifically conducted trials. We have conflicting evidence, some of which suggests that there is a relationship between certain items in the diet and cancer, and equally convincing evidence from other studies which fail to demonstrate that.
One of the first big hurdles we faced was finding witnesses to prove our case, but we soon managed to get a list of about 60 together. Some of the world's top experts on diet and cancer stepped forward to help, including Professor Colin Campbell, who flew over from America to give evidence.
The high fat intake, the high animal protein intake, the lack of these other things lead into increased risk for cancers of various incendiary kinds, increased risk for the various kinds of heart diseases, diabetes, the kind of diseases that actually kill upwards of three-quarters of us in Western societies before our time. It's clear the science is really on David and Helen's side. It's not on the McDonald's side.
The World Health Organization have been saying that people should cut down on the fat in their diet and eat more fiber and so on in order to cut down on their risk of getting heart disease and cancer. And if bodies such as they are making those statements, then you should be able to say it. Whether or not you can call some top expert to, you know, prove it conclusively is irrelevant.
I think worldwide, if you look at the rise in fast food consumption, it's very closely linked to the rise in obesity. Throughout the Western world, life expectancy is probably going to decline because of the obesity epidemic. You know, you can point to many causes, complex causes of obesity, but I think there's no question that the amount of fast food and soda that people are consuming is a major cause of obesity. Everywhere that the American fast food diet goes, people get bigger.
Well, I want to ask you about another document
about advice to the public.
A diet high in fat, sugar, animal products and salt, and low in fibre, vitamins and minerals is linked with cancer of the breast and bowel and heart disease.
Is that a reasonable statement?
It has been linked, yes.
So would that be a reasonable statement?
Well, it depends to whom it is directed.
The public.
If it's being directed to the public, then I would say that it is a very reasonable thing to say. But if it's being directed towards the scientific community, then I think one would be a bit more careful in the language that one used.
Well, that's actually a direct quote from the London Greenpeace fact sheet, which is the subject of the libel action.
Here they were suing us to try and prevent us saying that diet was linked to heart disease and cancer. And, you know, their own expert was saying it's a very reasonable thing to say. I mean, to me, that should have been the end of it. The judge should have said, right, well, we don't need any more on this.
The cross-examination was devastating so far as McDonald's were concerned, and many top lawyers would have been very proud to have got the answers that Dave and Helen managed to get out of McDonald's experts. And as a result, Mr. Rampton had to move the goalposts of his case. Instead of saying the particular phrase meant one thing, he now argues that it means something completely different.
I'm really exhausted.
Yeah, I
know. It was okay then, really. I mean, it was really stressful.
It didn't get anywhere, that's the main thing.
Yeah. It's quite funny because the transcript, sometimes it comes out with that me and Dave have said something, 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 my lord. We've never once said my lord because we believe in treating him with respect as another human being, but don't believe in deferring or what have you. We do stand up, though, when he comes in. Which is a bit of a sellout.
I think Helen and me have a particularly good working relationship because we've campaigned together on a number of issues for over 10 years. We shared an allotment. We even shared a house for some time with other people as well. But that's about as far as it goes. There's no sex angle, I'm afraid.
May it be credibly suggested that McDonald's wish to sell food leads them to deceive people as to the composition and the health value of the food?
McDonald's spend $2 billion every year creating an image of the company that's nothing like the reality.
I meant McDonald's.
They're actually selling poor quality food, junk food, but they're advertising it as though it's healthy. We tracked down an excellent witness on this issue who came over from Texas to give evidence.
The point was the entire ad campaign, not one little claim in one little ad, but the whole campaign was intrinsically deceptive. We didn't mind them promoting their foods. We weren't trying to stop them from selling their foods. Our concern was simply that they would be selling it under a false pretext, that they would be telling people, don't worry about eating at McDonald's because you're really eating healthy food. And I do believe that for McDonald's to call its food nutritious is a lie to the public, whether the British public or the American public.
Do the plaintiffs aim, and I quote, nearly all their advertising at children?
Kids, let's teach everyone the new McDonald's song.
It was realized pretty early on that people's eating habits are formed in childhood, and that if you got people eating this food young, they would eat it for the rest of their lives. The average American child sees 20,000 junk food ads per year on television. And, you know, that is their nutritional education. That is how children are being taught about food. There's no aspect of children's conscious life that they haven't tried to infiltrate. The home, through television, schools, through advertising in schools, through marketing in schools, movies, sports, you name it. You can't market guns to kids, you know? You can't market alcohol, and yet these fast food chains, and McDonald's in particular, are targeting children with food that, you know, is going to have long-term unhealthy impact on their lives.
Because I'm in court every day, I can't pick Charlie up from school. I can't get back in time, so I've booked him into a play centre after school. Charlie was quite excited about the play centre organising a fun day, all the parents and children taking part. And suddenly, though, I walked into the centre and there was a poster of Ronald McDonald on the window. McDonald's, of all people, were taking over my son's fun day. So on the day, Ronald McDonald and 12 minders turned up, bringing with them a so-called donation of £500. But it was obvious it was nothing to do with helping the community. It was just about great publicity for them.
I don't think I've seen so closely just how pernicious their tactics are in invading the minds of children and hyping them up and effectively brainwashing them.
The magic word we will use today is Ronald McDonald. Now, when I count 1, 2, 3, I want you all to shout as loud. 1, 2, 3. Go down and shout. Try again. 1, 2, 3.
What happened today only further convinces me that we've been absolutely right to spend 5 years of our lives fighting to get over the truth about McDonald's, because they're so dangerous when they target vulnerable children. And now I'm only angrier and more determined to see this case through to the end.
McDonald's, to try to justify themselves, have had to bring all their big guns into the witness box. Researchers, paid consultants, heads of department, top executives, members of their board of directors.
We comply with all legislation, all regulatory agencies in our advertising practices, and I stand by those.
Normally, if you're campaigning against a multinational, if you ever get to speak to somebody, it's a PR person and they can just, you know, trot out their glib answers. Whereas when you've got an executive in the witness box, they can't walk away. You know, they have to answer your questions.
Why is it continually necessary for the McDonald's Corporation to have that constant bombardment of young children with commercial advertising?
First of all, I would not agree with your characterization of bombardment. It is certainly a large marketing effort. And if the children enjoy these activities, we would want them to participate in them. Obviously, we want them to remember McDonald's, and by remembering McDonald's, the next time they have a chance to go out to eat, they might select that over one of our competitors.
Lots of fun.
Lots of fun for everyone.
For everyone.
Advertisers like McDonald's are very aware of pester power. Pester power is, as any parent will know, is the ability children have to pester them for something that they want. And they can exert a tremendous amount of influence. And this has been recognised by marketeers.
One of the biggest battles that we had throughout the trial was getting McDonald's to hand over the relevant documents. It took literally years before they handed over their operations manual, or the Bible as they call it.
Remember, children exert a phenomenal influence when it comes to restaurant selection. This means you should do everything you can to appeal to children's love for Ronald and McDonald's. Birthday parties are an important way to generate added sales and profits.
Happy birthday to you.
Offering toys is one of the best things to make children loyal supporters.
McDonald's give away gifts and collectible items with many of their meals, particularly their Happy Meals, which are targeted towards younger children. And of course, if you want to collect the whole set, you have to go back week after week.
The sign that says you're welcome, a visit to McDonald's makes your day.
Hi, boys and girls. How you doing today? It's Ronald McDonald, your friend, and boy, gosh, by golly, we're going to have a lot of fun today.
I mean, I was like, who was the guy in the Third Reich who was the propaganda minister? You know, that's what I was, you know, Ronald McDonald. Kids love him, and they don't know why they love him. They love him because they were told to love him, and somebody paid somebody to make them love him.
These are adults trying to manipulate little kids to get their parents to spend money in a certain way, and if they were selling the most wonderful health food, maybe you could justify it. But that much time and energy and effort to manipulate children to do something unhealthy is pretty appalling.
I'm drinking Cola Coca.
I mean, anybody can really manipulate a child. You know, this is not that difficult. And I just went home one night and I said, no, I cannot do this. I can't live with myself if I continue to do this.
19th of August, 1994. McDonald's wants to settle the case out of court. They must be worried. We're not going to let them off the hook, though. Don't want anyone else to have to go through this ordeal.
We got a note out of the blue that McDonald's wanted to meet us any place, any time, and they would fly over members of their board of directors, which they did, because they wanted to settle the case. And they flew over to have secret talks with us, me and Helen.
Motivation, I think, was not to interfere with free
speech, but to it to prevent total untruths and irresponsible things from being said.
Not that the wage is allowed.
We can,
you know, minimum wage is low, it's low pay. We can stop people from saying that in the country to make it illegal speech.
Well,
why shouldn't we say things in the UK that people can say in America?
Because you choose to live in a country where maybe you can't say those things. They allow caning people in the Shanghai too. That doesn't mean we're going to go cane you.
We made it absolutely clear that we would only consider allowing them to pull out of the case if they apologised to all the people they'd sued in the past who had made similar criticisms to us and guaranteed not to sue people in the future.
We won't agree not to file suits against other people. We will not discuss our going back and apologising or paying compensation to anybody not in this room.
It's quite serious to say to someone you can't hand out any leaflets, full stop.
I don't think you ought to hand out leaflets about McDonald's. I think you've played that card. You've done it. You've had your day in the sun. And I'm insisting that any comments you make about McDonald's has to be private.
We wrote them back a letter saying, we would consider that if they agreed not to run any more advertisements about McDonald's, and said, of course, this agreement wouldn't prevent you from privately recommending McDonald's to your friends and neighbours, sort of thing, but they didn't reply to that one.
I've sat through almost as many cruel days as you have. I must say, I've admired your tenacity, your strength, your courage and strength, and I'm afraid my interpretation of what's going on with
you. Is it what?
You're taking the beating.
But if we win this case, and you go out and distribute that pamphlet out in the street again, you're going to jail.
Wouldn't that be a benefit to the McDonald's Corporation?
No, but it's not going to be a benefit to you either. And that's what I understand. Why you're screwing around with this?
In some ways, I feel sorry for the McDonald's Corporation. Not really, but in some ways, I feel that Burger King, Pizza Hut, and everyone else should be getting equal attention, because we are criticising what corporations in general are doing.
Then why don't you really have to say anything about us or say anything about Burger King?
Well, then we won't be able to say about anybody.
There was really such a gulf between the two sides that they just couldn't bear to accept any of our demands, really. And so it was back to court.
Morning.
So you doing the cross examination today, are you? Am I doing it? Who's starting?
You can start. I'm not ready. Okay. That's for you. Mind you, are you ready?
I state the issue in this way, and I hope your lordship will think it a fair way of stating it. Is the plaintiff's use of resources significantly detrimental to the environment?
Any company as large as McDonald's is bound to have a huge and usually very bad impact on the environment. I mean, when one thinks of all their tens of thousands of stores worldwide and the demand that McDonald's as a corporation creates for wood and paper pulp and chemicals and metals, the environmental impact of these production processes is huge.
We take our environmental responsibility very seriously. We take the goals of reduce, recycle, and reuse and apply them where practical across the entire business.
McDonald's has absolutely nothing to do with the rainforest in terms of beef production. We never have, and we never will.
We always knew it would be an uphill struggle to get evidence of direct involvement by McDonald's in tropical forest destruction. After all the witnesses and the official documents and so on were on the other side of the world, and we didn't have the resources to track them down and bring them to court.
you sit back and think about some of the witnesses that could have come on behalf of Dave and Helen, but didn't because nobody could pay their airfare, the verdict pales into insignificance. It's meaningless. If both sides had had all the witnesses they wanted there, then a true verdict might have been possible. But with the best will in the world, the judge can only give a verdict according to the evidence. And the evidence costs money.
Isn't it a fact of life that virtually every main street has a great amount of McDonald's packaging?
It is not a fact of life.
Dozens, if not hundreds of items.
Not a fact of life. I walked through Paddington this morning. I found one McDonald's package, which I disposed of. So I think that is a gross overstatement.
There were two on Waterloo Bridge this morning, but I didn't dispose of them, I'm afraid.
I would have done.
During the summer last year, I really felt like I needed to get away from the case and get away from McDonald's as well. I went up to Scotland and I climbed up Ben Lomond on one day. You expect it, everywhere you go in London, you see their litter and so on, but, you know, I climbed up the top of this mountain. It was the last place I expected to be reminded of McDonald's, and there you are, there's someone sitting at the top in a McDonald's T-shirt. You can't get away from them.
The campaign is going to continue. McDonald's has completely failed to silence their critics.
I'm normally quite a private person, and I actually find it quite hard talking to the media. I feel absolutely fine speaking in court, but put me in front of a camera and I just want to curl up.
We think we've already won, whatever the verdict, because
McDonald's efforts to intimidate and silence its critics
has completely backfired. Effectively, the tables have been turned.
And it's McDonald's and their business practices
that are on trial. McDonald's have had every conceivable advantage that money can buy in this case.
The one thing that we believe that we've got that they haven't
is the truth on our side.
And that's why it's going on so long.
Jeremy, back with you there now.
It's particularly frustrating when you spend, you know, a couple of hours talking to a journalist about all the issues in the case, and then 2 weeks later you see the article and it's sort of stuff about your haircut, what jumper you've got on.
We got more and more frustrated with the mainstream media ignoring the real issues. But then, out of the blue, a solution came along, some newfangled invention called the internet.
16th of February 1996. We're launching the new website in Leicester Square this morning. Finally, the public will be able to get the real story, the complete story.
This McSpotlight website is a library of information about the McDonald's Corporation, all the things they don't want you to know, and all the things they've now failed to stop the public finding out about.
We've taken what Helen and Dave did one stage further and made this available internationally for all time, never to be censored again. Now you can have the original leaflet in many different languages and print it out and distribute it.
We're now launching the site.
Got it.
Right.
It's coming now.
I don't know if you can see it, but it's coming up on screen. Look, Spotlight.
There it is.
We see what we're doing as enabling society to have the information it needs so that people can choose whether they want multinationals, whether they want junk food, whether they want McJobs, because they've got the full information to decide for themselves.
You do not see, for the most part, strong, outspoken criticism of McDonald's by the major television networks because they're so dependent on McDonald's and the other fast food chains for the advertising dollars. This was an incredible new way to get around the stranglehold that the corporate media had on information.
McSpotlight really pushed things up a gear for us. More publicity, more donations, and lots of people coming forward wanting to tell us their experiences with McDonald's.
Sarah, it's about 8:10.
We've had a lot of witnesses coming from all over the world and had to find a place for them to stay. We couldn't afford hotels, so quite a few of them have stayed in this house upstairs in my spare room.
Been a bit of a culture shock the first day I got here. And he showed me where the bathroom was. I said, well, where's your shower?
I've met so many people, from eminent scientists, you know, to ex-workers from McDonald's, from Norway, you know, and it's just been a fantastic experience.
A lot of my friends and family think I'm a bit crazy for coming over here right in the middle of exams, almost. But a lot of people don't understand my passion about this. To be able to stand up to a corporation and let them know what they've done to people like me. A lot of them think I'm sort of an extremist, but I'm not really.
Then I pass to employment. The issue I pose here is, do the plaintiffs cynically exploit their workforce for the sake of a fast buck? Are the plaintiffs hostile to trade unions?
We believe companies should be profitable, but profit cannot be the only consideration. And in the case of McDonald's, it seems to be absolutely the overriding consideration. The type of work organization promoted by McDonald's, this extreme breaking down of simple repetitive operations and so forth, is essentially dehumanizing.
The McDonald's kitchen is deliberately designed to control workers and offer as little initiative and creativity and voice to the worker as possible. They're basically treated like cogs in a machine.
It enables the worker to be extremely replaceable.
Interchangeable workers.
Extreme exploitation of the workforce.
Cheap workers.
Low skill, low pay.
High turnover.
High stress.
No benefits.
Exhausting and unstable jobs.
That's why these are called McJobs.
I love the way you turn it. It's great.
A skilled worker would have to be paid a decent wage. So by having so much elaborate high-tech machinery in the kitchen, the knowledge is being built into the operating system. And you're not relying on the knowledge of any individual worker, and you can get rid of whomever you want.
People want to be part of a winner. They want to be part of something successful. Hard work doesn't frighten youth today. Not at all. They want to be part of something that's victorious, something they can see as the shining light.
Good morning. Welcome to Hamburger University.
It's no surprise to me that as many as two-thirds of the fast food robberies are inside jobs, either by workers or former workers or friends of workers. When you're happy with your job, you don't generally try to hold up your employer at gunpoint.
Well, in Ontario, there's two minimum wages. There's one for under 18s, which is lower than over 18s. And McDonald's seems to hire huge amounts of under 18s because their wage is a lot lower.
The minimum wage in the United States right now, adjusted for inflation, it's the lowest it's been in more than 50 years. So this is a pay cut for the poorest workers in the United States. The fast food industry has played a large role in ensuring that the poor get that pay cut and the ripple effect you can see throughout society.
How many billions of dollars do they make profit in a year? You know? If they could maybe give half of that back to their employees, you know, it might be better.
When we argued that in court, the judge kind of intervened and said, you know, the company's owned by shareholders, and if the shareholders don't keep getting these profits, then they won't be shareholders, and then the company will close down. He seems to be sort of completely judging it on their terms. You know, we're entitled to put forward a different view and argue that we want a society that's not run for the benefit of shareholders, but that's run for the benefit of everybody.
When I was a postman, I was secretary of our trade union branch and very involved in trying to improve conditions at work. I remember delivering letters to a McDonald's store, and when I saw how they used to treat their workers, that's when I first thought that there was something really dodgy about the company.
If somebody amongst the crew was a member of a union or wished to be a member of a union, they would not be allowed to collect subscriptions, would they, from other people in the store?
No, no.
They would not be allowed to put any notices on the notice boards?
No.
They would not be allowed to inform the union about conditions inside the stores?
Well, I don't know how we could stop that. If we found out about it, yes.
Can I summarise it this way? They would not be allowed to carry out any overt union activity on McDonald's premises?
That's absolutely correct, sir.
Can you do better than that?
It got to the sort of stage where I just felt I was going around the twist, continuously thinking about McDonald's. And believe me, it does get mind-numbing thinking about McDonald's the whole time. It had the effect on me if I ended up dreaming about them as well, which was really horrible. I mean, it's more like nightmares. I got a job working in a nightclub. It's just quite a release from the case because it's so busy in there. I work there on Fridays and Saturdays from 10 at night until 3 in the morning, and I get paid £64 a week, and that's basically what I live on.
McLibel support campaign.
The McLibel support campaign was set up and run by volunteers on a shoestring from someone's bedroom, and they coordinated publicity and protests against McDonald's throughout the trial.
We're getting short on the press releases, aren't we?
Well, the campaign has raised about £30,000 so far, all from donations from the public, and that gets spent on witness airfares and legal costs and really whatever other expenses come up. I mean, it might sound a lot until you find out that McDonald's have spent about £10 million.
During the time of our trial, McDonald's have made $3.6 billion profits. They've opened a new store every 4 hours and expanded into 31 new countries. It's not just what goes on at McDonald's itself that's the problem. It's that key practices that they've pioneered over the last 50 years are spreading throughout society and becoming the norm.
And those key characteristics would be uniformity, conformity, and control. Control over the worker, control over the consumer, and a very homogenous culture that tries to stamp out genuine iconoclasm and tries to control what can be said about these companies publicly.
We've invested our lives, especially the last 3 years, have been just constant pressure of administration, of the paperwork, preparations and questioning and all kinds of legal complexities, all down on us all the time.
Principles extracted from the case of Derbyshire are equally applicable.
After court on Friday, I went to the doctors and got a certificate to say that I'm totally exhausted and that I need a break. I just felt totally burnt out and I wasn't really able to carry on. So we're going to be making an application for the court to be adjourned for 2 weeks. Just so much stress, really, that, you know, we ended up taking out on each other.
It's actually very easy to shift
them from
one
document
to another.
I can't do it. That's just a fact.
Well, if you took about 2 minutes, you could
do it. No, I can't. As the case goes on, it's even more difficult just to do the basics in looking after him, because I'm just getting exhausted. And, you know, and he picks up on it. Picks up on it when he's in the way instead of just being at home and being himself.
Are you glad that your dad did the court case then, or do you wish he didn't?
I'd be doing more things as well.
What, more things with him, you mean?
Yeah. And I have a bit more toys as well, I think.
How come?
I have more time to get a toy.
The doctor recommended that I should have a 2 week rest break, but the judge basically ignored it and ruled that the trial had to continue. 1st of November 1996. McLibel is now the longest trial ever in English history. Certainly feels like it. Nearly 2.5 years already. A bit longer than McDonald's original estimate of 3 to 4 weeks. But at least the end is in sight now.
My lord, the rearing and slaughter of animals is next. Here I express the issue in this way. Are the methods by which animals to make McDonald's food are reared and slaughtered cruel and inhumane? Would you summarize for us what is your attitude to the welfare of animals which are used to produce food for human consumption?
My conceptions are that no animal will put on weight or grow unless it is healthy and consented. You cannot force an animal to increase its weight. So I definitely think that we have consideration for animals and their well-being, and I do, both in terms of abattoirs and in terms of farming.
On my farm in Montana, I had 7,000 head of cattle, 12,000 acres of crop, 30 employees, 7 combines, 20 tractors, 30 trucks. I was buying $1 million worth of chemicals a year. We'd eliminated the birds, killed the trees. My brother had died of Hodgkin's disease, which we found caused by dioxin from the weed spray we were using, 2,4,5-T, better known as Agent Orange in Vietnam. Doctor told me I had a tumor on my spinal cord. If it was on the inside of the cord, I had less than one chance in a million. Now, when somebody gives you the odds of one in a million, it really gets your attention. I had to admit that I had done some things to that farm that were not very good. Well, I'm sure a lot of the meat that I sold ended up in McDonald's.
Our standards exceed minimum legal requirements. And if those legal requirements need to be adjusted, that's really a matter for government. It's a matter for agriculture. But I want to know about it.
We've been sent some great footage taken secretly inside one of McDonald's chicken suppliers. It's pretty grim. We're going to show it in court today. The conditions for the poultry are outrageous. Every day, about 1,300 adult birds have their throats cut while still fully conscious. And about 1,000 unwanted chicks are gassed every week.
These creatures have lived for a millennia one way, and in a few decades we've transformed how they live, what they eat, and how we eat them and where we eat them. So BSE and E. coli 0157H7, and now maybe even avian flu, is a logical result of fundamental transformations in how we treat animals, how we have transformed animals from sentient beings into industrial commodities and units of production.
Most people have no understanding at all that animals are being fed to animals. They have no idea that we are feeding arsenic to chickens, that we end up recycling manure back through the animals, that we feed them cement dust. Most of us have no idea in the world who produced our food, what they used on it, what it'll do to us, the environment, or the animals.
The point I was making was that Mr. Walker seemed to be accepting that as a result of the meat industry, the suffering of animals is inevitable. Is that correct?
Are you asking me a question? Sorry.
As a result of the meat industry, the suffering of animals is inevitable.
The answer to that must be yes.
17th of July, 1996. Evidence finished. Yes. Now somehow we have to condense all the evidence into a coherent closing speech to convince the judge to rule in our favour.
We've got 40,000 documents, 20,000 pages of testimony. It's impossible without a trained team of, 10 lawyers to even read a tenth of it. Just too much for us. I mean, we're so exhausted and we're just losing concentration now at this crucial time.
It's quite possible that, you know, we could fail at the last hurdle in this case.
It's got to the point where I just don't have any time for Charlie anymore. And, you know, communication's broken down between us and I just end up shouting at him. And I just got to say, look, Charlie, just go off and play because I've just got work to do. I mean, it's already 2 a.m. and I'm completely knackered. And yet, you know, tomorrow morning I've got to stand up and we've got to speak for 6 weeks non-stop. In our closing speeches. It's just an impossible task, really.
Libel laws are being used in this country as a draconian form of mass censorship, which is largely carried out in secret, largely self-censored.
The allegations in the leaflet are false. The picture of working life at McDonald's painted by the leaflet is a grotesque...
Ronald McDonald is one stranger parents certainly should warn their children about. We know he has ulterior motives.
There may be a causal relationship between diet and cancer of the breast and bowel. On the other hand, there may not be.
Bearing in mind the similarity between the passage in the fact sheet and McDonald's own pamphlet, it was extremely
impressive. Promotion by McDonald's of beef consumption, their huge advertising budget as the world's largest user of beef.
It's just because they do not like groups such as London Greenpeace drawing these problems to the attention.
Ways in which the fast food industry harm their customers and staff and animals and the planet.
One of the reasons the fast food industry grew so quickly and is still the food of the poor and ordinary working people is that it's cheap. But it is very similar to smoking and tobacco. The real cost and the real consequences doesn't come in the moment. It comes 10, 20 years later. When you look at the cost to people's health, when you look at the cost to the environment, when you look at, you know, how our labor system has been transformed, and on and on and on. This is not cheap food. This is extremely expensive food. This food is too expensive for our societies to pay for.
Because wealthy people and corporations control all the media, it's very easy for them to, you know, shape the way we see the world. Buy this product and you'll be happier, and for them to convince us that, oh, there's no point in fighting back and that actually everything's okay, and just leave it in their hands.
I think human beings are amazing. Look at all our, you know, inventiveness and creativity and all the great things, art, music. Surely we can come up with something better than this current economic system, which allows a few people to get obscenely rich while half the planet have to live in poverty.
For me, the most important thing is to just be awake and alert and alive and conscious and not just kind of a captive of these corporate marketing campaigns.
Right now, we have governments that are doing the bidding of multinational corporations. And they are, in fact, the government of the world. Can they totally intimidate individuals? Can they remove our rights and freedoms? That's what this trial is all about. The trial will not be decided in high court. The trial will be decided in the court of public opinion.
June 19, 1997. Judgment Day, the 314th and final day in court.
I think I should wear this. I'm going to do it.
Even though I look like a vicar.
I look like a vicar. Do I?
My conclusions are as follows. It has not been proved that a diet high in fat and animal products and low in fibre leads to a very real risk of cancer of the breast or cancer of the bowel, although it is possible that it increases the risk to some extent. The leaflet's message of a very real risk of heart disease, simply from eating at McDonald's more than just occasionally, is not justified. I do find that various of McDonald's advertisements have pretended to a positive nutritional benefit, which McDonald's food did not match. The sting of the leaflet to the effect that McDonald's exploit children by using them as more susceptible subjects of advertising to pressurize the parents into going to McDonald's is justified. It is true. The blame for litter, which has left McDonald's restaurants as packaging in customers' hands, lies firmly on the inconsiderate customer. Although the expansion of beef cattle production has led to the destruction of rainforest, there was no evidence that McDonald's has taken any active part. McDonald's UK does pay its workers low wages, thereby helping to depress wages for workers in the catering trade. McDonald's are strongly antipathetic to any idea of unionisation, but they do not have a policy of getting rid of pro-union workers, as the leaflet alleges. I do not judge McDonald's conditions of work other than pay to be generally bad. McDonald's are culpably responsible for cruel practices in the rearing and slaughter of some of the animals which are used to produce their food. That leaves the question of the amounts of damages to be awarded to McDonald's. I assess the damages at £60,000.
We appealed against the verdict later and managed to overturn two of the key rulings. The appeal court ruled that it is fair to say that working conditions are bad, and crucially, that eating too much McDonald's food is linked to heart disease. And then they reduced the damages to £40,000.
Prepared to do anything it takes to defend the public's right to criticise multinational corporations.
As far as we're concerned, what would have been a loss is if we hadn't fought this case and people had been intimidated into trial.
We are, as you can imagine, broadly satisfied with the judgment given this morning. It's my responsibility to protect our reputation, and that's exactly what we've done. Very serious allegations were made about our company. They were proven to be false.
They had the libel team, the expert team of lawyers, working for the last 5 years behind the scenes and in court for them. That's where the victory lies, in the fact that Dave and Helen won almost half of this case with those odds stacked against them.
But he said you exploit children by using them as more susceptible subjects of advertising to pressurise their parents into going to McDonald's.
Well, I don't remember the exact words. When I have a chance to read the specifics, I'll be able to comment.
What's your response to those precise words?
I don't know that he said those in that context. I'll have to look at the complete document.
The judge has ruled in our favour on all those counts. What action is the legal system going to take against McDonald's? That's the question everyone should be asking.
Well, this wasn't a matter of costs. It wasn't a matter of damages. It was a matter of establishing the truth. That's what we set out to do. That's exactly what we did.
We're not going to pay the damages. McDonald's don't deserve a penny, and in any event, we haven't got any money.
Here, right?
21st of June 1997. Today is Mass Defiance Day. There's going to be protests outside over 500 of McDonald's UK stores and lots around the world too. They haven't seen the last of the leaflet.
McDonald's had a rough time post-McLibel, and McDonald's experienced its first loss, I think, in 2002. I think in a long-term sense, they're in big trouble, and I think that McLibel had a great deal to do with that in terms of unleashing this torrent of criticism. Besides the American way, get it
back, get it broke, either way you're gonna pay. These numbers are outrageous.
Unfortunately, you caused some major harm to your heart, your liver, your blood.
It's not as though there are people setting out to tarnish their image. It's just the reality of their business practices are becoming known.
Some of the issues that Dave and Helen were raising, such as junk food and advertising to children, were not widely debated 10, 15, 20 years ago. But now they are mainstream. The case appears to have altered McDonald's tactics. Since the case, I don't think McDonald's has even threatened anybody with libel proceedings in similar circumstances.
Well, I didn't want to go to jail, but, you know, I think I would have been prepared to do it just because otherwise the alternative is to give in to their intimidation. And I think they just realised it would be a complete PR disaster to have us jailed and, you know, just loads more bad publicity for them, so they gave up. And then on top of that, they've never collected a penny in damages. I mean, obviously we weren't going to pay any, but they haven't even tried to come after us. After the trial finished, I carried on working in a nightclub for several years, and then I spent a couple of years training as an electrician and qualifying as an electrician. I'm also involved in a housing co-op. A group of us got together so that we could have more affordable rents and more control over our own housing, and we're in the process of trying to buy a bit of land and then build our own houses.
Excuse me, Flossie. Excuse me.
Excuse me. Thank you.
In some ways, McLibel was a bit of a sidetrack for me because my main activity has always been in my local community. As you can see here, this is something that that we were successful in getting £1 million for. Traffic calming throughout this whole estate so that kids can play in the street and people can cross safely.
I would actually like to be an actor slash stuntman, believe it or not, because I enjoy acting and just, yeah, being creative. Come on.
5th of September 2004. Train to Strasbourg with Dave for the European hearing. We've beaten McDonald's, now it's the UK government's turn.
Dave and Helen are now taking their case to the European Court of Human Rights, which is the most important court in the whole of Europe, and will seek to argue that UK law is in breach of the European Convention of Human Rights, so the stakes could not be higher. The European Court is going to have to consider a number of fundamental issues about English libel law.
The first is the obvious unfairness of a system that allows one party to have huge amounts of resources and lawyers and the other to have none without any legal aid. It's only for libel proceedings that you can't get legal aid. In every other kind of legal case, legal aid is there to achieve the balance that's required for justice.
For me, the significance of the McLibel trial is really about, you know, this worldwide movement now to oppose entrenched corporate power and corporate wrongdoing. There's no one person responsible, but there's no question that when Helen said no, it really fueled the fire. I'm not going to bet you money that McDonald's will vanish tomorrow or that we will suddenly you know, transform our society into a compassionate and caring and humane one tomorrow. But when I was born, there was segregation in the South, and black people couldn't ride the same buses or, you know, sit at the same tables with white people, and Nelson Mandela was in prison when I was a kid, and so things absolutely can change.
Okay, so we know you don't like corporations, but what's the alternative?
The alternative is basically taking control of our own lives, our own communities, our own workplaces, and making all the decisions that affect our lives and affect the environment. You know, deciding what happens to the resources, deciding what work needs to be done.
People say, oh, it could never work, you know. You just have people going around and doing murdering and stealing and things like that. But actually, that's what happens in this society now. You know, you've got corporations and wealthy individuals that own vast swathes of the planet and deny other people access to them. And it's basically stolen from everybody else.
Obviously, there's always going to be problems in any kind of, you know, group of people or society or whatever. But you want to remove all the unnecessary problems. For example, poverty in the midst of plenty, or some people owning 50 houses and other people don't have a home to live in.
Most so-called kind of antisocial behaviour is actually people fighting over the crumbs that are thrown from the table. The real people who are behaving antisocially are those that control all the resources and deprive other people of what should be shared amongst us all.
If we remove corporations and governments who care only about profits and power and, you know, take things into our own hands, obviously that's basically transforming society. That's a revolution, but not just on a single day, over a period of years building up strong grassroots movements until one day we can take over all the decision making ourselves and look after our planet.
September 7th, 2004. European hearing this morning. Kind of ironic that we finally got legal aid, so now we've got a whole legal team with us. Keir has to do all the talking. We're not even allowed to speak.
This is Parissa Wright, our assistant solicitor. This is Keir Starmer, our wonderful QC. And this is Anthony Hudson, our junior barrister. And this is Mark Stevens, our solicitor.
I've put in all the additional bits we discussed last night.
Sure.
I've cut out, in order to make it 30 minutes, the bits I've had to cut out are Professor Nicholson. In its
quote.
Entirety.
Oh, right. What, even the meaning?
No. The section
the
dealing with overstrict thing.
Yeah.
I don't think that matters. That's
that
dealt
stuff
with
about fact and comment and all that. That one that was repeated six times.
I never understood that anyway. So we'll leave that out.
It's long been recognised that it would be wrong for central and local government to be able to sue for libel because it restricts free speech. And we're questioning before the European Court whether that rule shouldn't be extended to multinationals. They often have more power and wealth than small countries around the world. They can get their message across through the television, through other media and through advertising, and they don't need to go to court through ancient and unfair libel proceedings.
Oh, no, don't ask any questions.
That was
great. I thought the government's totally on the defensive, certainly on the lack of legal aid, which they've now recognised should be available in defamation cases in exceptional circumstances.
The government referred to that protection of freedom of speech should require that campaigners should put the balance in their leaflet and put the response of McDonald's, for example. Well, there's no requirement on McDonald's to put the balance in their adverts and say, well, actually, our food isn't healthy. You really... probably better not eating it.
Yeah. The campaigners are the balance, and we will continue to campaign until there's a just world.
February 15th, 2005. European court verdict arrives today. Hopefully this is the very last day of the McLibel legal battle. No court hearing, though, just notified by email. Bit of an anti-climax after 15 years.
Hi there.
This is such a welcome. This
Helen,
is
great to see you.
We're just trying to prepare two press releases so we can get it out as quickly as possible rather than write it from scratch. We've got one in case that, you know, we lose on all points and another one in case we're victorious.
Controversy or something.
Oh, for God's sake. You and your controversy, you're obsessed with the word. Let's find out. We might as well find out now. It's 9:30.
Come on then. No, we're just checking it right now. Well, it might be. Hang on a second. One. What was that?
No, it's a spam, actually.
Yeah.
How can you get so much spam in 1 second?
I know.
Yeah. Who are these spammers?
25 to 10, and they haven't sent it yet.
My watch makes it 32, actually.
We've phoned up the court.
I think that might be a little bit impatient.
Stop. No. Internet. See, it's coming in.
Don't shut that! Sure. Don't shut it!
Okay. I'm going to phone the court, it's ridiculous. See if they've sent it.
Can get the number.
Just don't. They're probably trying to sort it out and you making endless phone calls is not going to help.
No, you're saying there's a technical problem. Okay, go on, here we go then.
For someone who doesn't care about the European Court verdict, he's extremely excited.
I'm not excited, I just want to get it over with, for God's sake. Actually, I've got an extension, we can...
It's here.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
Da-da-da.
It'll take half an hour to download.
It will.
Da-da-da-da-da. Wait a sec.
European Court of Human Rights press release issued by the registrar. The United
Court held
the European Court of Human Rights has today notified in writing a judgment in the case of Steel and Morris versus the United Kingdom. The court held unanimously that there had been a violation of Article 6, right to a fair hearing, of the European Convention on Human Rights, and that there had been a violation of Article 10, freedom of expression, of the Convention.
You know, there's tons of media interest, so I'm not sure if we can get to everybody. So, 11:30 at the Strand, yeah, but an email's going out in about 3 or 4 minutes. We're just doing it now, and then we've got to rush down there.
Better take the judgment down. Anyway, the media's not going to be going anywhere.
We've actually got to get our press release out on this phone, so there you go.
Hello, yeah, is it live or what?
Freedom of speech, too.
Well, McDonald's pulled out all the stops and pulled all their big guns into the courtroom.
Libel laws, nil.
You know, heads of departments and members of their board of directors, they had a full legal team, they spent about £10 million trying to halt the distribution of criticisms, public criticisms, leaflets and so on. It actually backfired on them completely. That was World Service, BBC, which is great, because that goes all over the world. Hello, Kia. Oh, okay, excellent. Good news then.
Phone, banner, placard.
Hi, Charlie, listen. Just leaving a message on your answer phone. We won our case, okay? I know you're having a good time. Hope everything's going well. And I'll speak to you later. Okay, bye.
Okay.
Go, let's do it.
She's a single parent, she used to be a gardener. Between them, they've secured a landmark legal ruling against one of the world's most powerful companies.
Still protesting after all these years. But today, Helen Steel and David Morris have something to celebrate. So they went back to the pavement outside the fast food store where it all began, to hail what they're calling a landmark legal victory for the little man.
The government says it's studying a court ruling in favour of two environmental campaigners who successfully challenged English libel laws after being sued by McDonald.
McDonald, and indeed any other multinational company, will think very carefully before launching a legal action like it again.
Good evening. They lost to McDonald's, but today they won against the entire English legal system.
Just move back a little bit.
Underneath those golden arches, outside a central London branch of a company that must wish it had never taken on these two campaigners, David Morris and Helen Steel said they had no regrets.
Over this leaflet cost McDonald's an estimated £10 million. Even before today's ruling, it's been described as the worst corporate PR disaster in history.
Appropriate then that two people who would probably never go inside a McDonald's hold their press conference outside the fast food chain. They say the resistance will continue.
The important thing is that people should always stand up and fight for what they believe in and, you know, make the criticisms of the way that society is currently being run.
In the David and Goliath situation, you versus the multinational, despite all those findings against them, fundamentally, they won.
I don't think so. I think fundamentally they lost.
It has been a David and Goliath battle, but not in the way that the media has portrayed it. The reality is it's the public that are the giants. In this battle, there's billions and billions of us, and corporations like McDonald's are just a small elite acting in their own interests. When the public begin to stand up and get organised and speak out about injustices, then nothing can stop us.